Anyway, the good, the bad, the ugly, event sourcing, yeah. So the first question I have is actually, who has any experience with event sourcing? Just to check.
Ooh.
Like at least 20 people in the room. Okay. And who's actually interested? Well, no, I shouldn't be asking that. Maybe you're just, all the other sessions were so that bad that you choose this one. I have about, I would say, 7 years of experience. So I can say, like, everybody who has a lot of experience with something, you've felt the pain. And of course, when you felt the pain, you're trying to find the great ways, and then you start to talk about that. Quick introduction of myself, not to bore you. Yeah, it works. That's me. I'm on an everlasting quest for knowledge that significantly improves the way you build your key systems in an agile world. Yeah, I hired a marketing specialist. But I read a book, and yeah, the book said you had to have a model. At least this is my Twitter handle, and I call myself the continuous improver. I have a couple of open source projects, have a blog, the continuous improver, where I talk a lot about event sourcing and also other topics. I've been publishing coding guidelines for the last, I don't know, 18 years, basically since .NET C Sharp 1.0. And if anybody from .NET space here? A couple of people. You may know Fluent Assertions, which is a small little library, pretty popular these days. Anyway, it doesn't matter. So let's talk about event sourcing. I put in .NET between brackets because it's not really relevant, but it's kind of an introduction of what is event sourcing. So let's go. I have only 45 minutes for 60 slides, so I need to hurry. I have an application. The application sends a command. Let's say create a customer email, sorry, correct customer email command. Really functional, like intention revealing. It ends up on a command surface, then goes into what we call like a, I don't know, command handler. Any domain-driven design people, practitioners? A couple of, so I will not spend too much time on that. It will find something called a unit of work. A unit of work is a pattern, basically. You can look it up in the book of Martin Fowler. He wrote extensively about that, which will load or talk to something what we call an event store and get the entire history of this particular customer. So it's basically the command handler, which is supposed to answer the functional command that's being sent here, and then go into the event store and find the entire history of that customer object. So there's no record saying, I'm going to get the customer with the user of the customer ID and the address and all that stuff. Now I'm going to load the history. What happened there? So customers created, customer got a particular account value, customer has a max spending limit or something like that. Everything is there. It's all loaded from what we call the right database. At that point, we create, in this case in .NET or whatever, create an actual instance of the object at runtime and reinitialize the instance with the history. And at that point, it looks exactly like if you would store it as a traditional record in a database. At that point, you actually execute the command, in this case, correct the email address, which will apply a change to itself. And then at the end, the unit of work is told, like, okay, I've made a couple of changes because you could have multiple commands, especially if it's a complicated user interface. And you send that back to the application store, sorry, to the right database. This is the write side in event sourcing. The problem with this is you can't actually query on this write database. That's why it's called a write database. Of course, you can read, but you can't say, give me all the customers that have a certain are allowed to spend more than $10,000 a month. You can't do that. So you need something else for that. By the way, does anybody recognize this pattern or this architecture style? CQRS, Command Query Responsibility Segregation. I managed to say it without mistakes. It's really difficult long term. Indeed, CQRS tries to separate the command side from the query side, which is, I think, derived from Bertrand Meyer's CQS, which is a much more low-level pattern. So what we have on the left side, sorry, is a projector, and it's just a term that we use for that, that will handle a change. So in this particular case, because the email of the customer is corrected, what we store in the write database is an event. In this case, the customer email corrected event. That is what actually happened in the end. So we use the projector to take that information and project that into a data access layer and into a read database, which can be anything. And at that point, we have an application at the top that can do a request, say like, okay, give me some information. Give me, for instance, the all the customers that, you know, have a limit that's more than $10,000 a month. This is really event sourcing. That's it. There's a couple of interesting things behind that. By the way, if you're in the .NET space, there's a couple of things. I will not spend too much time on that. A couple of libraries, open source libraries specifically, that you can use. The star means it's my personal favorite. But since there's not a lot of .NET developers, I'll skip quickly on that. So there's a lot of good stuff to say about that. Let's talk about this. Projections. Again, app, domain, event store, and events. What you can do is you can build multiple projectors. You take the events and just build multiple representations of that same, you know, that same thing that happened in a domain. Because you know what changed in the domain, you can interpret in different ways. The point being is that every projector is also optimized for a specific purpose. So if you have lots of different screens or maybe different APIs, depends on the system you're building, you're supposed to build a really specific optimized representation of the data using the same stream of events. That's really powerful. A lot of people think like, but not duplicating data. Yeah, but that's fine. It's completely optimized for that particular purpose. If you want to provide a list of all the customers grouped by country, you can of course do a group by in your, I don't know, SQL database. But since you already have the information when it was changed and created, you can already do this upfront and provide the store the information somewhere in a persistent store that is available when you need it. Something like you could put it in a relational database and then you use whatever you want to use, maybe raw SQL or maybe an object relational mapper, doesn't really matter. You can even have a separate projection database. Well, it is a separate projection database. One of the big things if you have a really high performance system is to scale it. A database usually doesn't scale that well. Of course, we now have NoSQL solutions, but most relational databases have limits. Since there's no direct relationship between the data, you can completely scale out the projection side. And of course, great for partitioning as well, especially because each projector is creating a separate representation, completely independent from the rest. You can also put that even in a separate database if you need to. You don't have to, of course. You can put everything in the same database instance, but over time you can scale it out. You can also store it in a NoSQL database. And in this case, I've drawn the little arrow with dots to emphasize that this is running asynchronously. So just imagine that when the command comes in from the user interface or whatever, it's processed by the domain. You can either handle this synchronously, which means after the command is executed, if you would query the projection side, the information will be up to date, which is usually what you want. But limit scalability, you can also run it asynchronously, which means that the projector that's created on this side is kind of independent of what happens in the user interface. You need to take care of that, you need to account for that, but it really allows you to create a really high performance UI. You can go even further. You can have a projector that even creates an HTML representation. Let's say this particular projection is supposed to provide you with a user interface, like a page, like a grid or something. You can even have the projector, especially if it runs asynchronously and is autonomous, it can create an HTML representation that's already pre-rendered by the time the request comes in. You may even put it in the cache of the application server. So the application itself doesn't even have to execute code for that. That's really powerful stuff there. Another thing you can do is just imagine that you have, you know, this history we call as transactions, but these are more functional transactions. The fact that it exists, it means it also contains the entire history of everything, which is great for SOX compliance or for auditing trails. You don't have to keep a separate audit trail, you just extract that from the event store. It's already there. But what you can also do is look at the system or look at the domain at any point in time. You can go back in time. That's really cool because everything that ever happened is there. So you can start from the beginning and replay it until a specific point in time. That's cool stuff you can do. Reporting, yeah, that's usually kind of an issue because, yeah, you have this projection side, which is obviously optimized for the application that you're building. But what you can do is take the same events and build a more traditional relational database, you know, with foreign key constraints and all that old stuff. You can easily do that. You can even apply an OLAP cube on top of that. This is what we do in our production environment. But these are different worlds and different concerns. Of course, yeah, well, no, that's what I said indeed. Another cool thing is, which a lot of developers and architects don't use, is event merging. In traditional systems, if you would have, let's say, an order, and order is maybe a bad example, like a policy document, a legal document. If two people update the same document at the same time, what usually happens then? Optimistic concurrency exception or something like that? Or do we still lock our databases? I hope not. It used to happen on Oracle forms. But it was kind of difficult to handle like a system that has a lot of users touching the same data. You can, of course, remodel or redesign your domain to extract all this so that it doesn't happen. But if it really happens, if it's a really collaborative domain, it's really difficult to solve this. Well, the event merging can do some interesting stuff. Take, for example, this user, which is me, version 3. There's 3 events here. We have user created, we have role granted, and we have a phone number added. Now, this is what's stored in the main system. Now, from the UI perspective, I'm going to make changes. So I have a role granted that happened after this point. At the same time, my password was changed. I don't know, maybe because of an integration with Active Directory or something like that. And then I also changed my password. Now what? Is that a conflict? I don't know. Oh, and I also added a revoke my role to make it a bit more complicated. So is this a conflict? Granting myself or granting a user a role and changing the password? No, huh? Shouldn't be. No, it isn't. Who decides that? The domain logic. But who's in charge of the domain logic? Who makes the decisions about the functionality? Product owner, maybe? Business analyst, usually? Not developers, I hope. At least, I suck at it, so sorry. It's being recorded. Is this a conflict? Probably not. Depends if it's a different role. And worst case, if the same role was granted, then revoked, then the net result is nothing. So I apply this event on top of the history on the left side. Password change, yeah, that's probably a conflict because who goes first? That's a conflict. But maybe if you're talking with your product owner, the conclusion is, you know what, we'll just take the last one in time. And if the timing, if the difference is 5 minutes or less, it becomes a bit shady because there might be even clock differences. But if it's bigger, you can just say the last one wins. Which means, and all these, of course, are no conflicts because they're talking about different things. But the fact that you can make decisions on these, on this particular level, this granular level, and you can involve the product owner, I generally see that as an advantage. I don't know, maybe it's in your case, it's a disadvantage if you get business people in your project, but generally it's an advantage. I mean, I have always product owners that change their mind all the time. You guys have that? Or no, never happens? No. Anyway, so I put it on top of that. And then you have to basically a merge history of the two. And the same happens on the other side as well, of course. But this is really cool, especially you have lots of users and there's a lot of concurrency. And you don't have to apply this everywhere, just on the specific parts that are relevant. All right? This is also cool, a blue-green upgrade. You know, you build a system, there's a new version. How do you roll this in production? How do you deploy it in production without breaking the current activity? How do you prevent the users currently working with the system? You don't want to have any downtime. So what you can do with event sourcing is you can take the left side, version 1. Again, event store, projection, projector, and an application. Now I put version 2 side by side. And what I do is put a load balance on top of this. So they're kind of running at the same time. Version 2 has vastly different projections because it has a lot of new functionality. So what you do is you build a mechanism that so that version 2 kind of returns an HTTP 5 or 3, which is not available. Which means all the requests that come in through the load balancer will detect that one of the two systems is not available and redirect all the traffic to the first one. Then you start copying over the events. Since an event store is immutable, the entire history is available and never changes, even for GDPR reasons, you can just take those events and read them or copy them over into the new event store and then project them into the new structure. That's possible. You can even do that while the system is live. There's an interesting model behind it. You can also read about it on the blogs or talk to me, but you can even do this while the system is live, and only when you have copied over like 95% of the data, maybe only the data that was created while you were copying over this data has to be copied over at the end. You can retry this all the time until the gap is almost nothing. And then you bring the version 1 offline. So version 2 tells version 1, you need to go offline, which means version 1 will return 5 or 3. Then you copy over the remainder, and then version 2 becomes available. And it can become completely transparent. This is the way we do this right now with auto-scaling groups in Amazon. It's really cool stuff you can do with event sourcing. Or maybe redesign your domain. Since the domain is just a representation or interpretation of the events, you can take an aggregate as a DDD term, but let's say entities, the customer, orders, you know, they're stored in the event store. And then in a new version, you can take the same stream of events and rebuild that. You know, basically create a completely new domain from the same set of events. And I mean, as I just said, my PO changes his opinions all the time with new requirements. I mean, that's a sign of success. Being able to adopt your domain without touching your database structure too much is really cool. Especially if new insights, you've discovered that you've actually modeled your domain in the wrong way. You misunderstood the concepts and the relationships and the boundaries in a system. If you do DDD, that's quite a common thing. It's called a breakthrough. But not everything is awesome. There's a couple of things that you need to be aware of, and this is a really important one. Event sourcing is not a top-level architecture style. This is something that Greg Young, who's kind of been, well, he's not the real inventor, but he coined the term and has been talking a lot about that, has been saying it this from day one. And obviously, I ignored that and used it as a top-level architecture style. It's not. So if you have, for instance, multiple domains, in this case, a drafting domain, a policy execution domain, which is maybe something about legal documents, which is quite collaborative, and a search domain, would you use event sourcing for everything? No, of course not. There's no single tool that will solve all your problems. At least I haven't found it yet. If you find one, let me know. I'll become rich. A drafting domain is maybe something that just one person does. So it may be perfectly fine to have a simple solution with a really simple model that stores its data in a document database or something like that. Why would you use a relational database for something if it's just about drafting a document? In this case, we're talking about legal documents. However, the policy execution domain, where all the signatures are being set and the reviews happen on these legal documents, lots of people are involved, and this is kind of a made-up example, their event sourcing might actually be really useful. But it is an architecture decision that is something specific to the domain, not across domains. And even though this can be a single system, a single monolith, if you will, or microservices, if that's the next thing. And a search domain, yeah, why would you use something like an ORM or event sourcing in your search domain? Searching is the world of Lucene, Elasticsearch, and all these kind of tools. Use the right tool for the right thing. That's really important to do that. And I've seen a lot of people make the same mistake, just try to see it as an overarching architecture style and apply it to everything. That's what you get. If you have a shiny new hammer, everything becomes a nail, at least in my world. This has, by the way, some specific aspects, but it also means that a lot of people see the events that happen in the domain as a very nice messaging mechanism. I mean, you know exactly what happens from a functional perspective in your domain. Why can't you just take that event and bring it to the other domains and process that? It's really something that is difficult to avoid, something that really feels like an interesting approach, but you shouldn't be doing that. Because, as I say, it's a local decision to use event sourcing. So it shouldn't leak through the entire system. Excuse me. What you can do is maybe use a bus, I don't know, an event bus or something else, and one domain subscribes to that, the other one, you know, receives information, like the drafting domain is going to publish cross-grade events, and the policy execution domain is going to handle that. Because, yeah, we're talking about a legal document that's living in the NoSQL database. If anything changes in that phase that could affect the current signatures, the policy execution domain may have to, for instance, invalidate all the signatures on that legal document so that you have to start over. But this is something that needs to happen on the infrastructure level. The same between the left and the right side and the middle one. Maybe the execution domain provides webhooks that the other domains can subscribe to. Whatever technology works for you, everything is fine, but it's not a top-level architecture. In terms of the domain, well, let's look at a bit of an example. We have the application here. We have the shipping domain. What happens is we send the command, as you saw in the beginning, the command handler handles that, which will try to find the customer with a particular ID, in this case 123. Which will send an event that the shipping address for a customer has changed, and this is stored in the event store. So what happens with the orders that are being used? I mean, we've changed the shipping address for a customer. Should we update the orders that are already open? Yeah, that's a functional question. In this case, you have an internal, what we call domain event handler, that takes that event and acts on it. For instance, by finding all the orders, in this case 456, and changing the redirecting it or change the address, functionally saying I'm redirecting the order. That's perfectly fine. There's a couple of things. The messages from the outside, the commands, for me are messages. They're not types. It's quite common to take those high-level functional events and expose them as an HTTP endpoint, for instance. Don't make this a .NET type or a Java type or something and add all kinds of logic. It's just a message. Should even be serializable in JSON or XML or whatever is the current mechanism for serializing objects. For objects, also try to identify a partition key. We made that mistake. We didn't do that. Especially if your system getting really big, you can imagine what happens with your event store. It will just grow and grow and grow. Being able to identify a partition key from the start, so that you can use that to figure out later on how to partition the event store, it's a big thing, is really beneficial. We didn't do that. So at some point, it was really difficult to scale a system. There were millions of events. The whole thing, what I said about the webhooks or the bus, is all about not exposing those events outside your domain. It's a private, it's a detail. It sounds like a really functional thing. Don't use it. It's internal detail. And the identity should not always be the same thing as the natural key. Even a user, which has a user ID, maybe an Active Directory username, may sound like a perfect candidate for the functional key of an object until you discover that Active Directory allows you to change the identity and suddenly you have a problem. Be careful with that. Maybe a GUID or something else is more suitable. And one thing that we did is to have like really, you know, fine-grained events. And somebody made a joke about it. It's almost like we do property event sourcing. The events didn't really capture the intent of the system. We were not using the ubiquitous language, if you know this term. It's really important to think that. And events, obviously, should only contain primitive types. As soon as just imagine, you're going to load an event from the history. If you put anything more, let's say your event contains an ISBN number, a phone number, let's say ISBN number. You can, of course, encapsulate that because we love programming in an object-oriented way, so define an ISBN type that verifies the rules for your ISBN number. Now, you put this in a database. You have this event that contains an ISBN property. You serialize this to event store. Now, 2 years later, you try to deserialize this event from the history because that's what happens if you do event sourcing. Just imagine if the business rules for that ISBN number have changed. Suddenly, that old number doesn't match the current rules and your whole system explodes. Well, exception or something like that. So take that into account. Actually, I already said that, yeah. So what else? Oh yeah, that's also a nice one. It's a bit of a stupid thing. Try not to use words like create and update and delete and change. Why? Do our business users talk about that? No. It doesn't capture anything. If you do this, and of course we've done that, is you end up with these, as I said, fine-grained events that don't really capture anything. As soon as you see a developer creating a pull request and saying, I've added a new event called create user, try to ask them, like, what does that mean? What happened functionally? Did we just create a user? Or did the user enroll? Or something like that. Try to understand the higher level business meaning. Also gives you a better understanding what happens there. Transaction boundary is also something. If you go the purest way, they would say you should only have a transaction per object, customer, order. There's a lot of libraries that try to enforce that. So that means that this will complete first. So we change the shipping address, which means we actually correct the shipping address for this particular customer. And then in a separate transaction, we update the order, or we redirect the order. This is the puristic way and the most scalable one. But just imagine that this phase fails. So we send the command, the first one succeeds, but this fails for some reason. Database timeout, I don't know. The network is always available, but not. Then what? Then you have to build some mechanism to retry or something. Put it in a queue, because yeah, the order's already redirected. Sorry, the customer's already has a new shipping address. We still need to find all the orders. There can be lots of orders. That's the most scalable way. Another way is just say, I'm creating a big transaction around everything. That's perfectly fine. We did this. It's not the puristic way, but it has been working fine for us. We don't need the performance Let's say differently, we have not had any performance problems with the event store that required us to change the transactions into a small, much smaller scope. But it's a choice. You need to be aware of these things. Don't follow the puristic approach. Sometimes a practical approach is more useful. All right. Business code is more of an example. Quite often, so what you have is you have the actual object, in this case, the order with status. And it also needs to handle the event that is associated with it. In this case, you can put everything in the same class. So what you'll find is, in this case, a cancel method at the top, which raises the event on itself, and then another method that will update the state based on that. You can do it like that, or you can separate that. In .NET, you can, in C#, you can use partial class for that, or maybe a separate class that stores the state to keep your entities really clean, because there can be a lot of logic, depends on the size of your aggregates. It's just a choice. Event granularity, already talked about that. For instance, the risk assessment level changed. Then the team member was removed because a level one risk assessment needs a whole team. Sorry, a level two needs a whole team, whereas a risk assessment level one only needs nobody. So if the level is changed, wrong word, but okay, you go from 2 to 1, it means you also need to remove two members, like this. Or you say, no, I'm capturing this as one big event. Again, that's a choice. The first one means it's really clear what happens if the level changes. But it's also really clear for the projections, like, okay, if the level changes, you know, I just changed the level of that particular row in the database. And then I remove those child tables with all the users of all the team members that are associated with it. If you make it more higher level, then it's more intention revealing. It's not just a change of the level. We demoted the risk assessment level. But it means everybody that needs to handle this event and project it or interpret it needs to understand what it means. There's duplication of logic. This is a really difficult decision in event sourcing. And I have not found any good heuristics of choosing what one over the other. Versioning is even more painful. I mean, you go from a domain DLL, you go to a completely different DLL because your domain became much bigger, and at some point you decided to refactor your code. We all refactor every day. You refactor your code so it ends up in a much smaller structure. Yeah, you need to think about that. How do you convert one to the other? Yeah, you need event up converters. How does that work? Command service calls some method on the command handler, which will find the customer, in this case 123. Which loads from the event store, a customer created event. Again, crappy name, but yeah, that's the name the developer chooses. I have this event, which is then passed through a converter. And a converter can do all kinds of stuff. It may split or merge multiple events because you decided that the domain needs to be changed for that. It can also run maybe at the end of a migration, like you go from one version to the other, you run all this at the end. We have different products that do different things. You may change the identity. You discovered you used the wrong identity. So there can be a lot of complexity there. So the converter is in charge of fixing the events up, and then changes in this case in a customer enrolled event. So you go from customer created to customer enrolled. Just because we decided that created is not a good name, what really happened, a customer was enrolled in the system, and we aggressively tried to change the system accordingly. This is then loaded into the customer object, and then the rest is applied, and that's the end of it. So a converter is just something, or an up converter, different terminologies are used, is just something that runs in that pipeline. And that's it. Ugly side, yeah, there's quite a lot of ugliness. Projections that crash, yeah. Have that happened? Like the column was too small, because the domain increased the ISBN number to 30 characters because 20 characters was too small. We have now that many books. But the underlying SQL storage table was not updated. Data invariance, like it used to be an optional thing, now it's required, or vice versa. It was required, so it was created in SQL Server as a non-nullable column. But yeah, functionality changes. And this, of course, only happens when the project is updated. And if your projector is asynchronous, yeah, this happens probably even later, not even when the user makes a change. Dependencies between projections, because somebody thought I want to reuse the projection. That's perfectly possible. Bugs, like duplicate child records, have seen that because there was a bug and two application servers were both trying to update the same projection. And then they were both trying to add a child record like a one-to-many relationship to a projector, to a table, and both were doing it at the same time. Obviously, these things don't happen while you create your unit test. They happen in production during the weekend. Large event stream, that was also nice. We had an import tool that would update the roles of a user from Active Directory. But there was a bug in the domain that every time this happened, it would apply an extra event, even though nothing functionally changed. So at some point, we had an event store. For a specific user object, we had a million different events. And every time something happened, these million events had to be deserialized from JSON, from a database, into memory, applied on an object. Just imagine. Caching strategies, we have lookups. You know, and they use the wrong strategy, or two application servers were using different timings. Lots of stuff can go wrong. Identity case sensitive, yeah, that's nice. SQL Server, by default, is case insensitive. Postgres and Oracle are not. And your aggregates, yeah, the aggregate key is just a string, so it's interpreted any way it was added. But if you then store this in a database and try to find the existing record, that's really painful. We even had like multiple requests all trying to query on the same event store database, and because of transactions interleaving, you know, at some point the application saw a couple of events but didn't see everything, and then continued happily. These are really edge casey things, but they happen a lot in production. Long rebuilds is the last part. That's the most difficult problem to solve in event sourcing, especially between versions, as I just showed you. You have version 1 and version 2. You copy over all the events, and then you have to build up all these projections. Of course, these things, especially if you have lots of duplication there, different projects for different purposes, can become really complicated. So there's a couple of things. I'll skip this one because I already talked most of it. Lots of projections, different techniques, different caching strategies. You can find the slides after the talk. But one thing is what happens is, I saw a lot of developers switch to raw SQL for their projections. So just imagine I have a couple of events. You know, I have 6 events in this case, but just imagine these are thousands. So a projector, what it needs to do is, it gets an event, finds the corresponding row from the database, loads this row from the database, updates it, and writes it back. If you do raw SQL, you essentially have something like this. Every event, you know, in best case, it's just an update statement, but if these are 1,000 events, that's 1,000 different update statements. Means lots of network round trips. But everybody says, you know, raw SQL is the fastest way of doing this. I actually beg to differ, because what you can also do is use an object relational mapper. What is cool about object relational mappers, they have a unit of work. And people are like, you don't have this whole object relational mismatch anymore. No, but in ORM has a unit of work, and a unit of work has an identity map. If you don't know these terms, you can look them up later on. But the beauty is, if you have the same structure here, and they all these events apply to the same row in the database, let's say a customer projection or something, basically what happens, one insert, an update. At the beginning, the record is loaded into memory, all the events are applied, and at the end, you flush it back to database. It doesn't apply to every situation, but we've seen like a 400 times faster rebuild just because people forgot to accept the fact that an ORM can actually solve a problem for you. It's really specific to the situation. Again, don't dismiss ORMs just for that. To speed up the rebuild time, there's also a nice trick called archivability, which you can do. We use this as well. Especially if you have a big system, not all the data is relevant. Not all the data is actual. Usually there's a lot of data, there's like a small group of a small amount of data that's like really actual, like active documents, but a bigger chunk, and the chunk just increases over time, is irrelevant. So what you can do is actually archive it. How does it work? I have a graph projector. The graph projector tracks the dependencies between the documents. So when a document is created, it keeps track of that, and then, you know, processes all the other fans. It's just a projector with a different purpose. Then the document is closed. At that point, it will tell the document to start archiving, which doesn't mean anything, it's just a method, which will say, I'm going to be archivable. The document itself is going to raise an event. It knows about the fact that it's closed for a while, now we're going to mark it as archivable. Then we have a specific projector that will actually delete all the existing projections, as representation of that document, using that event. It knows it's archived, cleans up after itself. Then we have a separate projector that will also respond to the same event and basically say, I'm going to clean up the events in Event Store. That's a nice solution. And then the next time, you still have to copy the data between new versions, but you can actually skip that, like a particular projector in this picture on the right side can say, you know, I don't care about this information. I already know it's archival. I don't even have to project it. Data's still there, but you have to, you can skip it during rebuilds, which gives you a huge performance improvement during rebuilds. I'm kind of out of time. I have 45 minutes, I think. There's another slide. You can go take this further because there's a next slide you can download it later on. That also shows you that you can take this information and then start deleting information from the Event Store. It's kind of a no-no if you really have to be SOX compliance, but it's a possibility. Or move the data to a different Event Store that uses a slower disk or something just for reference purposes. There's a lot more to talk about that, but we're out of time. Don't hesitate to find me after my talk. There's a lot of information here. I've also added an extra slide with some resources. I blogged about all the pain points I had, all the advantages. There's also a new library I created, but that's mostly for the .NET space to make this all easier. I'm pretty sure you have lots of questions after that, but we can do that after the session. Thank you for your attention.